that has as much promise and possibility as this community. I've never seen people that can thrive in what in some cases are third world level conditions in some communities. But I think we have to talk about the full story. The full story is, yes, people are poor, but they're not poor in spirit, right? These aren't bad folks. Yes, people are broke, but they're not broken. And so that is the holistic story that we have to tell about North Philly. North Philly is full of so much promise. It is full of so much possibility.
Yes.
But what we have to do is come together like we're doing right now. Get out of our silos of great work and figure out how we can partner together to build the community that we all love. We started our country right here in Philadelphia. Right here in Philadelphia. And that is a privilege, that is an honor, but it's also an amazing responsibility. Any other city in this world is supposed to embody the American dream. It should be the city that started it all. And North Philly has and always is the heart of that city. And if your heart ain't working right, you got some problems. So right now in this area, and then I'll shut up and get to Principal Wayne. But right now in this area, North Philly, we are suffering from the highest levels of poverty and deep poverty in the entire city. To be poor is stressful. It's toxic stress to be poor and not know where your next meal is going to come from, not know whether you're going to have the basic things required to live your life in a way that is prosperous, whole, and holistic. And so that is a part of what we're going to talk about today. Our first conversation was about that deep poverty, about the things that we're going to need to do to move forward. But we have to talk about what are some of the effects of that deep poverty. And one of the effects is we have kids who are growing up right now who believe that story of death and decay, who don't believe that they are the people that, when I talk about that promise and possibility, I'm talking about them. So we want to talk about how all of us in this room, how all the people that we touch, how we can be best equipped to make sure that we're speaking life, that we're speaking healing words, and that we're talking to our kids like what they are, and they are the future of this amazing community. So thank you so much for that. Now, Principal Wayne, if you don't know Principal Wayne, she is the principal of Strawberry Mansion High School. She is an amazing, amazing woman and educator.
Yes, she is.
Her leadership has been featured. She's done a TED Talk. She's been on ABC World News. She's been on Nightline. And she grew up right here in North Philly. And you tell me North Philly don't produce amazing things.
That's right.
So she started out at Fitzsimons in 2000, after being a teacher for 20 years. She started out at Fitzsimons as a principal. She turned that school around. She turned it around. And then she went from there and found out that Fitzsimons and Rose schools, two schools she had worked with, were going to be merged with Strawberry Mansion. So like the leader, like the dynamic woman she is, she said, I need to be a part of that. She don't go where the fight's easy. She didn't go to Chestnut Hill. She said, I need to be a part of Strawberry Mansion. And then what's happening there? And it's so grateful that she did.
Yes. Yes.
As a KYW game changer. She has received the Philadelphia Magazine Trailblazer Award, and the list really goes on and on. So without further ado, Principal Wayman, thank you.
Yes.
I can go on and on. That you are not supposed to move forward. It means things happen. We can't control some things that have happened, but now what we do from there? What are we going to do from there? Are we going to use that to fuel us to move forward, or are we going to use that to destroy the rest of our life? And that's the question that I have to ask my students every single day when they sit in my office in tears, crying about horrific things. And I have to look to them and I have to say, give me a hug, I love you, but go to class. Because I tell them about the transformational power of education. And I tell them no matter what happened in your life, things can get better if they just educate themselves. And I say it over and I over and over and over and over. And what they tell me all the time, it sort of reminds me of this poem. So I'm going to read this poem to you because it sort of really talks about how they feel inside. Give me a moment. And this poem is, our deepest fear. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Ashley, who are you not to be? I tell them, you are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We are born to manifest the glory of God that is in us. It is not just in some of us, it is in everyone. And we let our light shine, we will unconsciously give others permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates us. And that's what I talk to my kids about yes, life is scary. Yes, it's fearful. You're fearful. You're in fear of the fear. You're fear of the unknown. You're fear of the outside of North Philadelphia. Because a lot of them elect to stay right here. Because it's safe. I know North Philly. I understand North Philly. I don't want to go anywhere outside of North Philly. I tell them there's a whole world out there. The same thing my mother used to tell me when she would put me on the bus every Sunday after church, me and my three sisters. And she would ride us on that C bus. I'll never forget it. All the way through, I thought those houses were mansions when I was young. Because I didn't know. And she would ride us from one stop to the end. Of it. Every Sunday, she would put a different bus schedule on the table. And it was out of the game because the bus was free back then. And she would say, what ride line do you want to ride on today? And that was our outing because it was free. But all along the way, my mother would say to us, look at that house. Do you like that house, Linda? If you like that house, you got to go to college to get that house. Do you like that car, Linda? If you like that car, Linda, you got to go to college to get that car. So I'm going to end by saying, I understand you are all professionals in the room to work with my children. But they don't need a pity party.
That's right.
They don't need no pity party.
That's okay? Right. That's
what
right.
What they need is encouragement.
Yes.
To tell them no matter what has happened in their life, no matter what it is, and I'm going to tell you, the things are hard, they still can make it. And use that to fuel them and to go back into their families and do great things and come back and do great things in their community. So again, I just want to leave you with not a pity party, guys. Don't pity them. They don't need your pity.
They need to strip. Thank you. We will define trauma and deep poverty and the connection between the two and describe what it looks like in individuals and community. We're also going to talk about resiliency and the role that that plays in the ability to bounce back, both in individuals and community. And then we'll ask, so why should we care about these topics? Why do they matter? We'll hear from the panel about why they care about these topics and how they've personally begun to address trauma and poverty doing work to change outcomes for children. And then, now, what is our call to action? What will be our public declaration and commitment to ourselves and to each other? My hope tonight is that we spend the bulk of our time discussing the so what and the now. And the reason why that is my hope is because I believe in the idea that our words create worlds, which is a phrase attributed to Joshua Heschel. Yes, we do need to talk about the challenges and problems. We need to call them out loud and clear. But too often these conversations get stuck there, sometimes leaving us feeling unempowered, depressed, or too paralyzed to act. And therefore, we'll spend a short amount of time at the beginning talking about the what, framing the conversation. Tonight, we want to create a space where we speak about the assets, the opportunities, and the possibilities that shine the brightest light on the things that people can do that bring about a change.
We're talking about, particularly for young people, having the experience of a traumatic event. What is a traumatic event? being a child witness to domestic violence or intimate partner violence, being yourself a victim of abuse, emotional, psychological, and sexual abuse, significant loss can also result in a traumatic event, the loss of a parent or a caregiver. These are traumatic events that can occur that impact and can disrupt developmentally the trajectory for young people. So I want to put this in the context of a large study that was done nationally by the CDC and one other, Kaiser Permanente, and it's called the ACEs study. And it's an important study because the original study was done in 1997, and they came up with these 10 like markers for trauma. And it was really good because it gave us a framework for thinking about how trauma really is. When we talk about trauma and we think about the connection and correlation with poverty, really is a public health issue. And that we should be looking at it using that particular lens. So I'm going to read to you actually the 10 criteria for the ACEs study. Recurrent physical abuse, recurrent emotional abuse, contact sexual abuse, an alcohol or drug member in the household, an incarcerated member of family, a family member who is chronically depressed, mentally ill, institutionalized or suicidal, mother is treated violently, the child witnesses, one or no parents, physical neglect or emotional neglect. So this study was done in 1997. It was done with 17,000 people, and you won't be surprised. What they found is that the majority of people had experienced at least one thing on this list. And I'll tell you a little bit about the demographics of the study. So of the study, 70% of the people were Caucasian, 70% of the people were college-educated. So that kind of gives you sort of a lens to try to understand that when we're talking about adding poverty as another variable, how those particular communities become significantly more at risk. And that'll take us to present day. So in 2013, the Philadelphia Healthcare Health Management Corporation also did a study, and they used the ACEs sort of as a framework to look at, you know, in Philadelphia, what is the experience of people here? And what they found is that 37% of Philadelphians who participated in the study, and it was a smaller study, around 17,000 people, but 37% of the people who participated had four or more of those 10 markers that I identified. And what that meant was there was a strong correlation between those folks having, those children or adults having, being at risk for negative health and physical health and mental health outcomes. So for young people, we should be really thinking about, if this is using a public health lens, then as we're sort of thinking about sort of how do we get to the other side as opposed to getting mired down in all of the things that are contributing to these negative outcomes for young people, how do we use this as a framework to then think about the other side? What are things that help young people thrive? What are the things that help to build resilience for young people? What are protective factors that we can build in our community, not only build, but that we can enhance that are already in our community? How can we increase social capital so that young people are really thriving in our community? So I just want to give you a couple of ideas about what are some indicators that a young person might be experiencing trauma. So for preschoolers, we see thumb sucking, bedwetting, clinging to parents, sleep disturbances, maybe a loss of appetite, withdrawal from friends, routines. For elementary school students, it's irritability, aggressiveness, it can be clinginess, nightmares, school avoidance. In adolescents, it can be sleep and eating disturbances, agitation, increased conflict, complaint, physical complaints, delinquent behavior, and poor concentration. And so if you think of all of those things can also manifest themselves as adults. So we're talking about trying to really sort of look at how to help young people not only be resilient, but thrive. We really are trying to think about how we can avoid from having these negative outcomes as adults. So the correlation really quickly between deep poverty. So just to define deep poverty, a couple things. One, Philadelphia is in the top 10 in terms of like number of cities that have deep poverty. So there are 10 cities that have been identified that have the worst poverty in the country, and we're in the top 10. Deep poverty for a single family, $57,000 a year is what they earn. That's deep poverty. And I cannot imagine how families are able to survive, let alone thrive, at $57,000. For two or more people, it's $11,400. That's deep poverty. And in Philadelphia, we have, oh, sorry. No, not that. There are, let me give you the statistics. 12.9% of our folks are actually suffering from deep poverty, and that's about 200,000 people here in the city of Philadelphia. That's taken from the census from 2009 to 2011. And 60,000, yes. And 60,000 of those folks are children who are suffering from deep poverty. So we really have to think about how we can do some work and really looking at the connection between trauma and the impact of poverty and all that comes with poverty. Lack of resources, dilapidated schools, teachers and administrators, youth workers, or youth professionals who are working really hard, but they're really working with bubble gum and spit because there's very little funding that's available for young people. Communities where young people feel like nobody really cares because communities are not cared for by our city in a meaningful way. Gentrification that may be happening around them while they watch their own communities crumbling. So poverty is a really powerful impact on young people. And if we think about the message that we're giving young people, poverty, we are really telling them we really don't care very much about it, which really results in them not really caring very much about themselves. So we have to be able to turn this around.
Thank you. So actually, I'd like to ask Principal Damon to talk a little bit about the young people that you work with at Thomas High School and describe for us the ways in which you are trying to change the outcomes for them.
Okay, it's interesting that I'm listening to this information because I've heard people say, I was poor as a child and I didn't even know it because my mother, provided and took care of it. We had everything that we needed. And so now I'm listening to the statistics and I'm thinking, wow, I may have been a victim of trauma and didn't even know it. But when you talk about these elements, that's almost half of my students. When we talked on a conference call about the type of children who experience trauma, I was thinking about maybe the young man who just a few weeks ago was shot at a house party in North Philadelphia, then turned right around and came back to school the next day because this was a safe place, but we had to take him not home, but to somewhere else that was safe because of fear of retaliation. Or maybe the child that I have who comes to the after school program or to the breakfast program because she doesn't have food, she doesn't have any support at home, and then when she does talk to us, she's talking about abuse and we have to call DHS, and then it takes hours sometimes for them to respond, so we're there until 6 and 7 o'clock. And so this is just a small example of what we deal with every day, and I can honestly say that it's more than half of my students. But I'll tell you, the thing that I do every day is just like Linda Wayne had said. I have to tell my children, this is not it. My mother didn't believe in counseling and psychology probably because she didn't have health insurance provide for it and we couldn't get all of those services. So she just had to tell us, listen, you have to learn to live with this and move on. And she made sure, if nothing else, we were educated. She worked for years to try and get us to go to college, my brother and I. And so with that, I tell my students the same thing. I dropped out of college at a young age. I didn't see the importance because I felt like I needed to work. Like many of my students, they don't see the importance of staying after school to be in a program to get the SAT up, which is really money within itself when you look at the scholarships that come with that, but they'd rather work at maybe McDonald's or Walmart and get the minimum wage now and forget about the scholarship they would get later. And so I've been just begging and borrowing, calling on different alumni, different community members, and I just ask people, listen, like you said, they need to know someone cares. And not someone just want to just come and do a one-day presentation. I tell people, if you have just 1 hour a month, they'll see your face regularly, and then they start to believe that someone cares enough and they should care for themselves. So I do believe that education is the key to success. And as I close, I just want to talk about one student that I remember so dearly. He delivered our commencement address this year. He was a class of 2014. During his 11th grade year, he was arrested for armed robbery. We knew he didn't do it. He calls it a miscommunication. I call it something totally different. He was a young black man walking down the street on a spring break, and they picked him up and said he was in. His father didn't know where to go, how to help. So he had to stay in jail until after spring break was over, come to the school, and as a legal professional, but I knew enough to call on some friends and say, listen, what do we do because this young man doesn't belong here? We were able to go down to the court, talk to his behalf. The public defender told us, oh, they'll never let him out on his own. I said, listen, I run a school home with 600 children. I said, I've had people here who are paid lawyers. Please tell them that we are here for this young man and see if it will make a difference. Sure enough, he was able to come home. Then I had to fight to get him back to die because they put them out and they have situations like that. You know, but just working with this young man, let me tell you, he's a success story. Not only did he take his place back as number one in his class after that experience, he got a full ride to Howard University.
Nice.
Because his first semester, his first month in college, his father was murdered in a hit-and-run accident on Lehigh Avenue. And so then again, we're calling on our friends and family to call down to Howard and make a way out of no way for his aunt that didn't know where to go. But you know what he told the young people at the commencement address? He said, listen, I've been in foster care for 8 years. My mother's an alcoholic. My father was murdered. I've been arrested. And he said, and I still, I cry. And so one thing that I tell my kids is, we're not just trying to make it. We're not just surviving. We want to learn how to survive.
Thank you so much for sharing that. There are a couple of things that I'm hearing as you're talking about your experience as a principal. And again, thinking again about this idea of positive relationships. There were some who believed, if this young person believed in this story. And I don't know if you've ever had a young person look at you and open their eyes that you're going to believe in them when they tell you something horrible that's happened. So here's a really great example of the power of positive relationships, having high expectations that he could come back and be successful, both in endowments and at Howard, and that they were going to create opportunities for him. So even the invitation to come back as a keynote speaker validates his experience. The last thing that stood out for me is this idea of Reggie mentioned social capital. What I heard was, I called everybody I knew. That's something else we can do. We walk out of here tonight and we think about, how do we change the outcomes for young people? We have to think about, can I have a positive relationship with the young person? Do I? Can I create high expectations for them? What are the opportunities that I know of that exist? And how do I reach into my own network to help young people build their own social network? And so we'll hear more about that as we go. I'd like to ask Meg to talk a little about the work that you do at Smith Memorial Playground to empower parents and families through play.
Thanks. Hi, everyone. I've talked to some of you who are in the audience, so I know there are a lot of adults in the room who visit Smith now and recognize it as a resource for their families, and I know some of you went to Smith as children, too. So I think while Smith is not an expert in trauma, we have for 117 years been a champion for children and a believer in the necessity that children have for places and people who care about them and can provide safe places for joy. So if you haven't been to Smith, it is 117 years old. It's just about 10 or 12 blocks from here. It's in North Philadelphia in the corner of East Fairmount Park. It was built specifically for children over a century ago, and admission for everyone is free on family visits. So it is an incredible resource for you or for what you just said. You know, what can we do for children? What is an action we can take? You can bring them to a space which is a beautiful park setting that exists especially and explicitly for play. That means children learning to get along with each other. Exploring their creativity, their imagination, learning, improving their physical health, and building the really fundamental blocks for growing up to be happy and healthy. We see the extensions of that when kids have time to do that and when adults recognize that it's important for children to do that with their time. That means that families are stronger. The great bonds that can exist between kids and adult caregivers, grandparents, or anyone in the community. Family to me is not just who lives in your house, right? It's everyone who cares about each other in a space. And then ultimately, communities are safer, and communities thrive when kids have opportunities to engage with each other in those ways. So I'd love Smith, if you haven't been there, come. We have 215,000 people who visit every year. 66% of our audience is from the city of Philadelphia, and 35% of our audience is from North Philadelphia. I'm really proud of those numbers. Smith is there for the people who live closest to it. So just recognize that, and when we think of, as Malcolm says so eloquently, there are so many assets here, let's connect them, let's use them. Smith is there for North Philadelphia. But beyond that, we recognize that there are so many children who don't have an adult in their life who can take them there. So we started a program about 5 years ago, and my colleague Kate Zinnick is at a table in the back with some Smith materials, and she's really the person who is most boots on the ground. So we have a number of social service agency partners, homeless shelters, domestic violence organizations. We do a lot of work with the Teen Elect program in the School District of Philadelphia. So we recognize that people who are experiencing trauma right now, when they're thinking about food or shelter or getting to be physically safe, play for children might not be on the top of their list, and making a trip out to Smith might not be a priority. So we take play to kids in those settings, in community settings, and at our social service agency partners, and we talk to adults, because lots of them, they grew up in traumatic circumstances, might not remember playing. That's not a memory or something that they can share with their kids. So we try to reinstill that knowledge and that joy and that fun, and provide suggestions for how play can be incorporated into family traditions and maybe new traditions around play for children. So that's been incredibly rewarding, and there are a couple of thousand people who participate in a program that we call Play for All, basically making Smith made mobile and identifying families who really benefit from play. So as we progress through the night, we are always open to suggestions for more connections for that type of programming. So I'm honored to be here. I'm not done a moment, but really proud to put a shout out for the ways that really simple ways that exist around us to help make children on a path to thriving and help them thrive right now.
Kinds of experiences that can produce relentless stress, parenting alone, The idea of a nuclear family will ruin us as a society if we're not careful. So parenting alone, dealing with multiple generation caregiving, stressful, doesn't let up. Poverty, hunger, these things don't let up. The thing about something traumatic, the experience could stop. Now the impact of the experience, you might still live with that, but the experience could stop. That's one of the main differences between something that is relentless and stressful. Where's the alleviation when you are a single parent making $30,000 a year working 40 hour weeks? That is relentless. And the same for the child living in those kinds of situations. So I put all that out there because the arts are so powerful. Both as, I took some notes because I'll ramble and preach about art all day. So I just want to keep myself together. But they're both preventative and protective, but also disruptive and healing. Disruptive in terms of cycles, right? And for individuals, for neighborhoods, for family systems. And so really, when we talk about art and the role of what we're doing at the Village and work I do with Neural Arts and all, a lot of other spaces and places, I know Hartwell is here in the audience and I adore all their work. I know the Future Project is here, the Dream Project is here, doing great work, right? There are a lot of great people here doing great work and they use art. Narratives are our building blocks. We all have an autobiographical narrative that rolls through our head. If we could cut it off, some of us would feel a lot more sane, but we can't. We deal with it whether we like it or not. And that narrative is constantly going and impacted by people, by situations, by our interpretation of what happens to us, by people's interpretation of us being in a moment with whatever we just did or didn't do, and they're layering us with language and feelings and opinions. And this happens very young and keeps growing and maturing.
Big mouth, I'm fine. from PNC Bank, and it's taken place in two of the libraries, in Cecil B. Moore Library and at Widener Library. They went out and canvassed people from a number of barbershops, brought them in. Jazz and a few others had some training on literacy for kids and how to label the everything it is. You know, he's got words up, mirror, chair, scissors, but not just scissors, but shears.
Right, right.
You know, and he learned how to stretch their vocabulary and all of that. So all
voice of doom, but the physiological impact of stress, as you describe, are so real. And just to remind people, even little children, preschool-age children, manifest that stress. So opportunities for them to de-stress through play with really simple solutions. And there doesn't have to be any expense involved, but just recognizing that time for children to de-stress, even kids who can't talk, really important.
Could I follow up?
I think she hit a really good point to that, and just why art is so important, particularly with young kids. A four-year-old has an emotional repertoire that can borderline rival an adult. They do not have the language capacity, but that autobiographical narrative is still being built, and a lot of it's being built through what we call somatics, through the body. So the body is remembering, the emotional part of them is absolutely remembering, but they do not have the language capacity to talk about it. And that's not going to come till much later. And so what is so important about play, the arts, the physical play, the emotional play, back and forth, serve and return play? It's a child's job. This is how they're going to learn about sharing and empathy and practicing empathy and how to navigate certain social and emotional terrains that might be a little tricky and involve some more complex thinking. If you think about how complex we are as an adult, take someone who's married. It is very possible to kind of like your wife in that moment if you're a guy who's married to a woman. It's very possible for you to kind of like your wife, love your kids, and hate your job all at the same time and love them that night, right? I mean, you can have this really complex terrain, and so can a child. So just bringing that stress level down, doing things with them that begin to equip them with language. That's what I love about the arts. We play, and we learn to talk about things together. We draw it out, et cetera. So
for parents who are already stressed, and it can be hard to figure out how to incorporate yet another thing. And I guess what I'm inviting you to do is to think about how play is also important for you as well. So we're talking about building narratives. We build narratives across our entire lifespan. So as we're talking about finding these opportunities for our young people, for your children, for your nieces, your nephews, your grandchildren, I'm encouraging you to also find ways that you can engage as well, so that you can play and also continue to de-stress, so that you're building a healthier narrative for yourself. So we're talking about young people, but I think sometimes in the conversation we can forget parents need this so much as well, and it's important to agree. It also offers the opportunity for us to continue to enhance and build those relationships. For young people, one of the most important protective factors for a young person is to have a consistent, caring adult in their life. So this is an opportunity to facilitate those kinds of relationships with them.
I'm finding so many different mentalities. It seems challenging. I don't say hard because the only thing hard is being concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge, and I was built for this. I think we all have a purpose in life. And most of us want to take more tasks that most of us back away from. Impossible. Some people say it's impossible. I see possibility. I don't see anything as being impossible. Mentalities, there are different mentalities, but just like there's different ways to teach people how to read, there's different ways to communicate people, and there's different mentalities. So I do see hope, and that's all coming together and understanding each other, and learning to respect